Welcome, everyone. I'm feeling that this is just an opportunity for resting in God together, welcoming holiness, which is just another word for our true nature. The love that we are, the self that we are. So it's an invitation to just let go of all expectations of yourself, all the expectations of what this experience is going to be. And it's just an invitation to be fully here and to just welcome really being in touch with our heart. So I have no expectations of myself. That I will speak, that I will sing, that I will have an effect on anybody. Because miracles are involuntary, they're not under conscious control, and the whole journey is about letting go of conscious control. And inviting a presence, inviting a spirit to guide us, to lead us, to show us the way moment by moment. And it's about surrendering to that completely with all of our heart in every moment. So I feel that's what this afternoon is going to be about. What might that look like? What does it mean? How do we do that? So in this moment, I just invite you to sit so that you're comfortable, close your eyes if you feel to. Sometimes my fingers don't work very well. I really let go of my fingers. Thank you. Singing of holiness, inspired by holiness, singing of holiness,
singing of holiness,
holiness.
Standing in holiness.
Standing in holiness.
There's nothing but holiness.
There's nothing but holiness.
Standing in holiness.
Standing in holiness.
Just after announcing that I was going to be holding the session, I just started dropping immediately into a really, how to describe it, just a deep experience of just being completely given over to the spirit, and I went in and sat down in the main house, and then there was a meeting, and I went to go and get some food, but I just had to sit down while I was making the food, and then I came back and sat on the couch and was holding a drink and the food in my hand, and then I was no longer hungry or thirsty. But my hands were holding the drink and the food, and I just started dropping in again into this experience where I just didn't feel that I could move. And there was no desire to move. So it's actually perfectly okay. And in the experience, I can feel completely surrendered to it, and yet very conscious, like very aware at the same time. And then after a while, there was a meeting going on, and there were questions being asked, and David was speaking, and and then at a certain point, I just asked if he could if he could help. And I just looked down, and he just took the drink and took the food out of my hand. And then when he did, there were some tears that just rolled down my cheeks. And it's just a feeling of being so given over to the spirit that it's like being a puppet, just being a puppet on the spirit's strings. And when the spirit is dancing you, you're dancing. And then when the spirit says rest and puts the strings down, you rest. And it's such a complete rest that you literally, you don't have a choice. And it's the same, like what we're, it really is the same. It's felt as being quite different. And at first for me, when those experiences of giving over to the spirit completely were coming, they felt frightening, because there's still a part of my mind saying, whoa, what's going to happen to me? Am I going to be okay? Will I be taken care of? And that fear has come up both in the more just giving over to what feels like a mystical experience, and also kind of being directed by the spirit into something new, where it feels like, whoa, I don't know how to do this or how this is going to happen. And it's the same self that's just separate self, you know, personal self, that's holding something together. That's the self that's being washed through an experience of having the spirit just come through us and move through us and be present in our awareness. And over this this last year in particular, for me, those experiences have really deepened, and it's very profound, because the, you know, that one thought, will I be taken care of? Every time that's come up, I've been shown how safe it is, how carried by grace we are. And we're never out of control in a scary way. You know, it's the fear can come up, oh, I'm not going to be in control. But we're never out of control in a way that's actually really scary. You know? One time I had this mystical experience, and I was just aware of this vastness of mind that I was. And we were with some friends, and Jason was telling this story about how he'd been driving the car one time, and then for 2 hours he just had no awareness of driving the car. And then 2 hours later he realized, whoa, you know, I'm driving the car again. And how amazing it was, you know, that spirit took over and drove the car for those 2 hours. And I just started laughing. And all this laughter was like happening, like the whole mind was laughing, like he thinks he was driving the car the rest of the time. So we're giving over to this awareness of this divine grace, this being carried in a river where we're like, God is the river, we're already in it. The river seems to be flowing, and there seems to be a destination of where the river's going, but it's all God. The river is God, the ocean to where it's going is God. And coming into this fully really just means that you are giving yourself permission to be carried and trusting that you'll float. started going into one of these experiences in an airport on the last tour, the Quantum Love Tour. And I could feel it coming. I just went into this cafe and I sat down in this cafe in the airport, and suddenly I felt like, oh, this is the most comfortable place in the world. Like, I don't want to leave. I can stay here forever. But we had an explain to catch. And at the same moment that I was going into that experience, our next flight was cancelled. And the airline offered to put up in a hotel for the night and rearrange the flight for the next day. That's the kind of love that's there for us. It's like Jesus says, I will rearrange time and space for you. He means it. Like, he means it. Like, give yourself over, dare to give yourself over fully, and see that it's all for you. Like, the whole universe is here to support you to wake up. It shifts from being, how do I do this? How do I wake up? What do I have to let go of? What do I have to go through? What do I... And that I, you know, focusing on the form of how this awakening is going to happen, is seeing it as some kind of, like, project or some kind of accomplishment that's going to be difficult. And it's about turning it around completely to, I give myself over to you now, and then you show me, you guide me, you use everything, right, in support of my awakening. And the deeper that trust, and the deeper that faith, the more consistent is the experience. The only time when we're not experiencing the perfection of the grace is when there's doubt in the mind. It doesn't mean that the perfection's not still actually happening, but we're just, like, blocked from feeling it. Like, I love that line that delay in time, it's impossible in eternity. Like, you cannot delay in the absolute. But it is tragic in time, because you believe in time, and so you're experiencing it. That's why it's tragic, and that's why there's all these... you know, we talk about saving time and wanting to move through things quickly. And that's all I have to say about that. Would you like to play Sweet Amazing Grace?
I just started hearing it.
Yeah.
comes to you. You give everything to me. Where I thought you'd ask for sacrifice, only riches to receive. I wanna give my trust to you. Give my life to me. Where I fear that I could fail you, you show me I can fly. Hide and seek, but do not find. I played for far too long. I was lost, but now I've found. Your sweet amazing grace pours through this song. When I take down the walls, your light comes streaming in. Where I feared you might reject me, you pour me holy wine instead. Try to hide from you, it's a mystery to me. And now I know your smile's my own, and I'm flowing it truly. When I knock on your in. When I take your outstretched hand, I know not where I am. You begin. Sweet amazing grace. Sweet amazing grace.
We all just want to know that we can't mess it up. And I'm here to tell you that you can't.
Promise?
I promise.
Thanks.
Yeah, we really can't. And when we know that, we can trust, actually. When we know that we can't mess it up, we can trust and we can be shown. But while there's a fear of getting it wrong, then you're trying to get it right. You're trying to get awakening right. You're trying, and you just take the reins back again out of the Spirit's hands. And so, yeah, I can do it. So just knowing that we really can't mess it up, that we're All we need to do is just give our absolute 100% attention and devotion to what's given in this moment by the Spirit for our awakening. Could you turn the radio down a bit? Thanks, I feel like I'm okay. Just 100%. Just 100% attention and devotion to what is given by the Spirit in this moment. That's all. That's everything. Because there is a plan of awakening while we believe that we are separate from God. And if you're not consistently happy all the time, you do believe you're separate from God, and so you need help. So while you need help, help is available. And a plan, of course, is a metaphor. In absolute oneness, there is no plan. But if we're not experiencing absolute oneness, we need a plan. We need a plan that's being given to us by a source of love. A plan where the instructions, where the guidance, where the prompts of where to go, who to join with, what to say, what to step into, what to let go of. We need a plan where those instructions in that direction is coming from a source that has the bigger picture. It has our highest good concerned. Because we can only be aware of a little part at any given time. Like personal perspective, human perspective, who we think we are, what our life could be about, or even what it might look like. It's so small. And when we're trying to make the plan ourselves and get it right, we're just going on some kind of idea for ourselves of what it could be. And the Spirit's plan is always going to be about going in some way into the unfamiliar, into the unknown. Because to the self that's separated from God, God is unknown. God is the unfamiliar. God is sort of abstract. And so the pathway of awakening, like opening up and going fully into that experience, has to be opening up through letting go of what we think we know, letting go of the familiar, to be taken into that experience of the unknown, the unfamiliar. And that's a description of forgiveness. Forgiveness is emptying the mind of what you think you know. It's letting go of grievances, which is what you think happened in the past. Or even attack thoughts that are going on in the mind now, including, I know how to wake myself up. It's actually an attack thought. Because it's blocking awareness of God, quite profound when you realize, like, so many of the thoughts, even when we think, that they're helpful. So we're tuning into an experience that is going to be taking us into the unfamiliar in such a way that we're shown that it's safe, that it's actually what we want. So the ego, the awakening is a journey of sacrifice. It's about, you know, really giving up things. But to the spirit, it's actually letting go of what is not serving you, to allow what can serve you to be fully in our experience. So do we have to let go of everything? Yup.
Come on.
Woo! There's a beautiful line in the Course. Forget this Course. Forget this world and come with wholly empty hands unto your God. That's not a future plan about form. The mind immediately goes, oh my God, I have to sell my house and give up my dog and move into spiritual community and stop wearing clothes I don't like and stop wearing makeup. And, you know, it's like the mind goes form, 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 form. And I'm not ready to do any of that, and so, oh, I just won't. Spirit's like, no, now. Now. Give up this world. Give up this Course. Lay aside everything you think you need, everything you think you are, and come with wholly empty hands unto your God. And then if there's a shift to come, then if there's a prompt to come, about something in form that would be helpful, that's holding you back, it'll come. But it's like a... There's another description in the Course where Jesus describes it like a... I think it's in the Course, I don't remember, they all feel like they're from the Course to me. It's like a child who's been riding a tricycle and loves the tricycle, but the child's growing and then, you know, their knees are kind of coming up around their ears and they're like wanting to stay on the tricycle and dad's coming up with this brand new two-wheeler bike with tassels and training wheels and saying, it's time. It's time for the two-wheeler. You can do it. And for children, like once the new bikes appear, they'll just like, at one point, they'll just like, you know, the three-wheeler is just kind of tossed in the front yard. And they're on the two-wheeler.
Yeah.
And that's really how awakening can be. When we're not afraid, when we're not like deeply attached to the three-wheeler, and we're welcoming, okay, what's the next gift for me? Truly, what do you have for me now? What do you have for me next? I'm willing to receive it. It might be a stretch. It's going to be taking me out of my comfort zone because what I know is my comfort zone. So there's going to be a stretch every time, you know, because this journey is about expanding our sense of self from a very limited self-concept to a greater and greater awareness of self. To the point where there's no awareness of self, or you are, you know, one with everything. And so every shift is going to feel like the baby chick, you know, that's kind of got comfortable in the egg, and then they're growing too big for the egg, and then, you know, they're going to have to, like, actually tap, that's, you know, because there's a readiness for tapping, and then come out, and suddenly, oh my God, a whole new world. It's like having to learn how to breathe all over again.
Oh, yeah.
And it often feels like that. You know? Going back to zero again. Back to being a baby again. Back to having to be shown again. Being clueless. Being dependent. With the same prayer, show me that I'm safe. Show me that you've got it. in humbleness. Meekness is not weakness. In humbleness, in true humbleness, where you're not pretending to know, because you actually have learned that you don't. But in true humbleness, where you're in that prayer, show me, you guide me, do it through me. I of myself can do nothing, you know, but through me, my Father can do all things. In that state of mind, there is a strength. There is a presence. There is a certainty. Insisting on being in control of our own life is just a cover over fear. So it's very good news to know that we no longer have to try. So I do invite you, if you have something on your heart that you would like to ask, or something that you can feel that you would be afraid of asking, it like would make you shake to say the words. I just invite if there's a question or something that needs to be shared.
You're saying we don't control our mind, we don't have to, because like for the last 2 hours, man, I've been having some real shitty thoughts, man. And so you're saying I don't have to worry about this, you know, they're not my thoughts, right? So, right. Do I have to try and control?
Yeah.
I keep trying to say, shut up.
You can't, if you try to stop or control, then you just, it's like battling with an illusion, you know, it's kind of, it just doesn't work.
But, I'm sick and tired of hearing the thoughts. So.
Yeah, that can happen, especially after just a lot of love or a lot of light in the mind. And when that love or that light comes up, it's like pushing up. It's like a volcano, you know, there's this light that's coming up and it pushes up the darkness that's on top of it in the form of like resistance or thoughts that is self-judgment, self-criticism. And just knowing that can be really helpful. Like there's this love in you that really wants to just be felt all the time, actually. Yeah, and asking for help is sometimes really seems really hard. But if there was a speed up, or if there was something that could make it move through faster, it's the help. Because we two or more joined, there I am. It's just a given. You know, we two or more joined with that intention of truth. The darkness gets dispelled. It just does. And we don't have to struggle on our own. The thoughts, you know, that are coming up to be healed, they're not, it's not like they're just ours or we're the only one dealing with them. Everyone's heard the same thoughts and dealing with the same self-judgment or self-doubt, self-criticism. So in the sharing of it, then often you, you know, it gets seen, oh, okay, it's the ego. I can't fix it myself.
Yeah. Right there, I'm confused when I hear when two or more are gathered together, joined together. So, say in Steve's circumstance, or mine, I don't want to go there, but what if I'm in the middle of the night and there isn't anyone, it's apparent anyone else, but then if I join the spirit in prayer, is that also two? At least two join?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good.
I'm so confused. I don't know where to find someone.
Great.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, it is. You're calling on help.
Okay.
So whether it's the form of, you know, Jesus in your mind or the spirit in your mind or the light in your mind, it's like you're willing to no longer be separate.
Great.
You know, if there's a mighty companion nearby, it's just another symbol of I don't want to hide and protect this on my own. I want to share it. I want to have it. I want to join. Really, that's the prayer beneath it. I want to join. Because, yeah, that's everything. Being joined is being healed.
I thought so, but I just wanted to absolutely sure. And then one more question. I was going to ask David, and the questions were close, so it's still here, so I'm going to bring it here. In terms of guidance, we began the session with, we can't get it wrong. And you know, God is with me wherever I go. So if I'm praying for guidance around, you know, the next step, let's say, a decision that's in my mind, and I can't get it wrong, then wherever I am, God goes with me. So is it just that I am open to guidance and that it's happening? Whether I'm, I guess this is the confusion, is how do I know that I'm following guidance and not something else, and except that God's always with me? Is my question clear?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, the fact of the matter is God goes with me everywhere I go. That's why you can't mess it up.
Right. And then in terms of I'm asking for guidance around maybe something that seems specific.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Can I get that wrong? That I've listened to the wrong voice or something like that?
Well, that's where the purpose of guidance comes in. And the purpose of guidance is to align with that part of the mind that speaks for God or speaks for love. It wants you to be totally free of illusions, to know who you are. And so that's the purpose of guidance, is to tune in with that voice and be aware of that presence. It's the only purpose of it. If you listen to a voice and then you seem to be experiencing fear and stuckness, you just become aware of that. And that's the discernment training. And you can tell by how you feel which voice you're listening to. And that voice for God is always going to be taking us deeper into the unknown, into, you know, more of an expanded sense of self. Whereas the other voice is going to be saying, no, maintain what you have, maintain who you are. What you've got's not going to last, so hold on tight. But just even in that, it's just becoming aware of the two voices in the mind. And the ego even turns guidance into something that is such a pressure, like you have to get it right. You know, if you get the guidance wrong, you know, something terrible will happen. You'll get kicked out of heaven. You're already out of heaven. So, and you're okay. You're actually okay. It's just becoming aware. It's like, oh, okay, that's the voice I'm listening to again. Okay, you know, back to you, God. That's it. It's just a realignment in every moment. What is your will for me? What would you have me do? And usually the first instruction is going to be just relax, take a deep breath, just allow whatever fear to subside, and then it's usually going to be just move on what I've already told you. Move on what you already know. Because again, we come back to the only time where there's fear is when there's delay. There's a pray, listen, follow. Pray, listen, follow. Mm. And at the beginning of the spiritual journey, you know, you kind of forget to pray maybe for a week. And then you remember, and then you might hear something. Oh, my God. And then you're too afraid to follow that for 6 months. And that pray, listen, follow, the gaps between the three get shorter and shorter and shorter. As you experience through miracles, that when you listen and follow, you actually get happier, and it's what you wanted, and you feel more peaceful. And so that gap gets shorter to the point where it just merges into one experience, where it doesn't feel like there's a separate self that needs to pray for specifics or for the direction. You're just kind of in the river, you know. But that pray, listen, follow is so, so important, you know. And we just can't underestimate the need for that, because that's where the support is, you know. That's where the help is. So the more we're remembering, you know, the more we're receiving that support. And
So I have a lot of fear arise, mainly in this room, in this moment of letting go of goals and aspirations, and really, like, even within my body, there's a sense of knowing that I want to share my gifts in these specific forms or ways. So if you could talk a bit about the balance, if there is a balance, between alignment and surrendering to the spontaneous, full-bodied flow of existing, and also being passionate about particular things in your life that seem important to share with the world. But within that, there's a piece of it that requires discipline.
Yeah. The spirit can use your skills and abilities. And it's all about the purpose. So the skills and abilities that you have can be used for awakening. But it is all about the purpose. The ego's purpose for the skills and abilities would have been self-improvement, or trying to live a successful, independent life in the world, to be financially successful, romantically successful, housefully successful.
No,
housefully, residentially. But, you know, to get settled, to kind of live some idea of a happy dream life as an independent person. That's what the skills and abilities really are used for, and there can be a great motivation behind wanting to develop those, you know, to be really good and successful. And when we give them over to the spirit, we're saying, you use my skills and abilities, you know, you take them and use them for my awakening. You know, use them to deepen my relationship with you. And then when that purpose is out there, then you're using it for forgiveness. And there's still a passion that can be there, for sure. But the passion for that that self-motivation does disappear. And at first, that's what the ego is terrified of. Mm-hmm. I'm going to lose my zing. I'm going to lose my, my spark, what makes me tick, my attractiveness as a person. And there's been a lot of effort, a lot of investment has gone into that.
Right.
It's devastating, actually, to approach that. And so the spirit is going to take all of that, knows that there's a fear of loss, knows there's a deep fear of sacrifice, and is going to say, I take you as you are. Give it all to me, bring it all to me, and let me work through you and use you to be a miracle worker with your skills and abilities. And I mean, this community is just an amazing example of that. Musicians come, photographers come, webmasters come, typists, accountants, lawyers, when they're needed, they show up. We're praying, okay, we could do with a lawyer. Someone fills out a volunteer application form. I went to Harvard. Because somewhere in the mind, someone's saying, I want to be used by the spirit too. I want everything I've got.
Right.
And what's been amazing too to see, even here within this community, is when there's 20 people here, there are 20 essential functions. And we couldn't do without any one of those people. Mm-hmm. When the numbers increased to 32 people, we're like, wow, thank God all those people are here. There are 32 essential functions. What can we do about them? The numbers go down to 18. We're like, we don't need all those functions anymore. Mm-hmm. It's been really profound to watch that the function is given by the spirit. Your need for God and your need to be used by the Spirit will bring you your function as you give yourself over to it completely. And then just go, okay, make it a good one. That becomes the prayer.
Make it a good one.
It's got to be better. And my life was pretty good, actually, as far as dream lives are concerned. So, yeah, there was a big dismantling and letting go in there for a couple of years. But then it was like, this has got to be better. This going home to God has to be attractive. Otherwise, why would you do it? So the Spirit's going to say, yeah, give me what you've got. I'm going to bring more love into your awareness, more gifts into your awareness. So until you realize that you are the gift, who you are, and even if all those skills and abilities just went, that you're it. Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about following the path of what is unfolding with grace and ease versus having obstacles on the path, and whether or not those obstacles are guiding you to be able to stay on the path that's leading you to grace and ease, facing the obstacles, and do you understand?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because I recognize that most of the time, obstacles are part of the healing part of the ego. And where do you make choices that are based on choosing God, grace, and ease, and staying with the obstacle, even when it's causing difficulty, and having the discernment to be able to choose God, grace, versus staying with something that continues to
Mm-hmm. Ultimately, like the journey, it's all in mind, and it is all about forgiveness, letting go in mind. But we don't want to get stuck there. Because this plan of, which is so joyful, the plan is the call of our heart. You know? And like, yes, there's walking through the darkness, and yes, there's fear of loss that comes up. And yes, there's specialness and special relationship, like, and entanglement that's being loosened from the mind. And yes, it's all happening in mind. And yet sometimes, you know, the plan does involve taking a leap. It feels like a leap. But it's not really, you know. Like these leaps that we take, they're kind of already known what they are. And usually it reaches a point if there's been a holding back where, you know, you end up feeling like a slingshot, like you've been pulled back, you're holding back, holding back, holding back, to the point where you're like, you know, I'm going to just stay here in the slingshot and forget. Something's got to release at some point. And sometimes when that slingshot releases, you get shot into your next step. And you're like, oh, thank God, I was ready for that. But yeah, it's so safe, you know. It really is so safe. Because we're so ready. I mean, by the time we reach that point where you've maxed out your forgiveness in that situation, you know, you've forgiven and you've been willing to see it differently over and over and over again. And you've gone into your mind and you've gone through the depths and gone through the fear, and then you're done. And sometimes the reflections shift, and so your next deepening step is right where you are, and you're like, whoa, this is like a whole new world. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it actually does involve a shift in form. And each shift in form, like each change, does bring up fear just in itself. Because change is not natural. Like, you know, oneness doesn't have change. Who we truly are is changelessness. So change has nothing to do with God or our true nature. But while we believe we're separate from God, there is a huge change that happened. There was a break from that oneness. Mm. So every little change that happens, there's like a reverberation of like, I'm going to die. I'm going to be separate from love. I'm going to lose love and lose myself in this change. Mm. And so the Spirit's plan often involves change, and again and again and again. So we go through it and go through it and go through it, to the point where you're no longer afraid of the change. You end up actually welcoming that, going, okay, what's coming next? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's where something like dance can be so supportive, because you're going into the unknown all the time, you know? You're giving yourself over to the music, you're giving yourself over to the movement, and like having something in your your life, whether it's journaling and listening, whether it's singing, whether it's gardening, whatever, going out in nature, like, yeah. Those are all just very, very helpful, supportive ways of letting go of control and being done through, so that when these bigger steps come, there's like a reference point for it. Okay. You're welcome. I have a song all about that.
Oh, I love
that. I have a song for that.
There's a line in the song about the real question. Because when we start to get really stuck on should I stay or should I go, should I end this, should I continue, you know, that that question ends up being quite debilitating. We get really stuck in it. Because the fear of sacrifice and the fear of loss is there, and where you go, you're going to be afraid. You could get it wrong. It's like the guidance, the fear of getting guidance wrong, same thing. And it doesn't really matter how big the question is. Do I stay married? Do I get divorced? Do I come to this retreat or not? We've had friends just so locked up in fear about even coming to a retreat, like, should I stay, should I go, should I come, should I not? And it ends up being like so terrifying, like this decision. And it doesn't make sense, does it? I mean, really, you go to a retreat or you don't. You're not going to die if you don't go to the retreat. But something in the mind is going, this is like, I'm going to die. Like, it's terrifying, like fear.
That's true, he didn't.
Didn't kill you. Didn't
die, Andy didn't die.
Good talk.
But that fear, it doesn't make sense. And so then what is that fear? It's not really about the question, should I stay or should I go? And yet that's the fear that we're actually allowing up to be healed. That's the fear. It's the fear that I could separate from God. That's the fear, that I could separate from God. It's like there's such a fear of it. It's like reenacting the unholy instant with every decision that seems to be made. You know, this could be the biggest mistake of my life, is what's coming up. So it's good to know that, so we have a context for when the fear comes up and we want to back away from what the prompt was or what the direction was, just to know that. Oh, it's the fear of separation coming up again to be healed. And just to know that and to be able to just return to prayer, take the deep breath, call on help, you know, call on support. And in the song, it's like, what was the real question? I forgot. Like, I forgot what to decide. And takes it out of, you know, this trying to make a decision about life and coming back to actual life. You know, what is your will for me?
Kirsten? It's funny because everything you're talking about is what I'm going to right now, because I felt to like ask to play guitar with you, and then it was instantly like there's still a lot of things, me like feeling like I'm going to be showing off or something. That's totally okay if you say no, but I feel I have to at least say that I really wanted to just play guitar with you.
Now?
Yeah.
I would love you to.
Okay.
Yeah. 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 Woo!
See, this is so
good.
I am not a musician. And I was praying, like a year and a half ago, I was praying for help, and I'd been in a deep hermitage, a letting go. This is what the song's all about. It was like a deep letting go time. And I was praying. I felt like I wanted to extend again, but I did not want to talk to people. I was not in a place of extending with others, but I needed, my heart needed to be extending. I needed to feel God. And I happened to be living with a guitar teacher, and so the Spirit said, ask him for a guitar lesson. And that was it. I just sat there and played guitar, like with one chord for 5 or 6 hours. So happy it extended. And then he showed me another chord. And by then I'd been praying and journaling. So I had a song.
Yeah.
Before I knew it. When I left there, I probably had 8 chords and 6 songs.
Is there another cable right anywhere close? If not, I'll go without some.
There is.
Okay. So I just trust you completely?
Trust you.
Good start. So you guys have never played together? Trust you completely.
And so I'll just play and you just join in with wherever you feel and whatever you feel.
Wow, that's
wow, this is gorgeous.
Giving us an example of trust.
Thank you. face rejection, to face the truth. I'm lifting the veil, the illusion of love. Willing to go there and lose it all for God. What is the question I need to ask? One through question. Reveal him on your path. He says none of this is random, it's all the Spirit's plan. I'm doing the unreal, the revealing of I am. Cause I've been holding on for fear, fear of losing you. Holding on for fear, fear of losing you. Holding on for fear, the fear of fear itself. Holding on, for fear there's nothing else. I wanna see past this. Go beyond this. I wanna see past this. Go beyond this. I see the protester, protesting I'm alive. I see the insister in my mind, insisting that I'm right. It's all a defending, defending to keep safe and a justifier. Justifying fate, but it's all the Spirit's plan. Cause I was holding on for fear, fear of losing you. Holding on for fear, fear of losing you. Holding on for fear, the fear of fear itself. Holding on for fear, there's nothing else. I was holding on for fear, fear of losing you. Holding on for fear. Fear of losing who? Holding on for fear, the fear of fear itself. Holding on for fear, there's nothing else. I want to see past this. Go beyond this. Can we see past this? Go beyond this. I see past this. I'm going beyond.
How many musicians ever made me cry, and that's twice he's done it.
Thank you for asking.
Thank you.
God's will for us is perfect happiness. Here's the proof. We're asking for proof. Here we are.
Listening, guys.
Can't get it wrong.
I sigh a lot lately. Yeah, I really feel like it's actually my purpose in this lifetime. First of all, it's the same thing, but I'm just seeing it now from a different perspective. It was to, wow, that's quite profound, actually. It was to be shown to truly know that love cannot come to an end. That was like my mission for this lifetime. And it was to do with, I believed it was to do with relationships, you know. And because lifetime after lifetime, you know, there's the tragic story of losing the one that you love, right when you just meet. And then again, in this lifetime, like, you meet the one that you love, you know, and you have this relationship or this assignment, this mission together, and then somehow it comes to an end. And there's just... I wanted to be shown in this lifetime that love does not come to an end. That even if a relationship or an assignment shifts, that the love is still there. And I've happily achieved that goal. It's deep. Seriously. To dare to stay with the love.
Yeah.
To dare to not turn away. To dare to not separate in your heart. Because if love was there then, love is there now. And love is not going anywhere. It could only be me who would leave out of some kind of protection, some kind of fear. Some story I make up that I'm no longer loved, I'm being rejected. You know? Or somehow that something's wrong, that this relationship came to an end. When I learned that in the Course, that every relationship is maximal, I was like, oh my God, that's it. It was maximized.
Yeah.
It was maximal. I learned everything I could from it. I opened my heart to the extent that I could within it. And everything that still seems unresolved, that's just what's still being resolved in my mind now. Dare to stay with the love. So I did that over and over. I'm with your sister. And I learned that through these relationships that were given me to show me, you're actually, the purpose for that relationship was to learn this lesson. Nothing else. So stay with your lesson, don't throw your lesson out with the bathwater. But now I realize, what I feel like, what I was going to say my purpose was that I just feel like I'm here to just tell everyone how loved they are. Like, truly, just how loved we are. And I feel like that's That's it. I'm not quite sure how they melded into the same one in my mind anymore.
But they did.
Suddenly it was like all the same thing. Like love doesn't come to an end. It's still here. So on behalf of God. I'll tell you that you are deeply, deeply loved. In every step you take to keep your heart open, to say yes to love is deeply appreciated. It's so worth it. Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah. Speaking of beautiful, I don't know if it was 15 or 16 seconds after I said that, the stuff went away.
Yeah.
I love you, Stephen.
Love you.
Yeah.